Hello everyone, I am Demented Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on a commander from Commander Legends, Yurlok of Scorch Thrash. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. The best way you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. For just $1, patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube, and higher tier patrons get access to the VIP section of my Discord server as well. You can find a link to both down in the description. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Yurlok is a 4/4 Viashino Shaman with Vigilance for 1 generic, 1 black, 1 red, and 1 green. If you pay 1 generic and tap it, it'll filter that generic mana into black, red, and green mana, which is an amazing mana generating ability available in the command zone. However, you're not the only one adding this mana to your mana pool. Everyone is adding mana to your mana pool. So why is Yurlok like Oprah when it comes to adding mana? Because while Yurlok's in play, he brings back Mana Burn. For all you youngsters, Mana Burn made the game more complex in terms of keeping track of things because any unspent mana that emptied from your mana pool would make you lose that much life. You can thank Mana Burn being eliminated as the main reason Mana Drain is so expensive now and a mythic in every reprint when it was originally an uncommon. In any case, no more having opponents generate obscene amounts of mana only to use a little bit and then disregard the rest. Yurlok once more makes opponents wary of how much mana they're generating, lest they get burned from it. And this is the direction I'll be taking the deck. I will punish opponents not only for generating mana, but for losing any mana I give to them as well. If they won't be gracious with my gift of mana, then they'll burn for it. So spake Yurlok of Scorch Thrash. Okay, so how do we go about punishing opponents? Simple. You put them in lose-lose situations. Opponents will no doubt want to use their mana wisely, lest they get burned for any excess mana. However, if they have more mana than they can use, they'll get burned for it, especially if they can't sink it into any instance or activated abilities. So if we make Yurlok generate a ton of mana thanks to Sword of the Power Runes and Umbral Mantle at the end of a turn, it's going to be very difficult for them to use it, especially if their decks are not in our colors. With just these and Yurlok, the deck won't generate infinite mana. However, the way these equipment work is that Yurlok taps for enough mana to activate these and untap itself. All you have to do is pay 1 mana each time to activate Yurlok. Basically, for each 1 mana you can get to activate Yurlok, his 3 mana untaps himself, meaning that only your opponents get mana burn. Even if you're able to activate Yurlok thrice, your opponents lose 9 life from mana burn if they couldn't use that mana. Speaking of thrice, you are able to generate infinite mana in this combo thanks to Nyxbloom Ancient. Not only is this amazing on its own, but it also triplicates the amount of mana opponents receive from Yurlok. All you have to do is generate enough mana with Yurlok to surpass opponents' life totals so that when their mana pool is empty, at the end of the phase change, they die to mana burn. If you're worried about generating too much mana with Nyxbloom Ancient and getting mana burned yourself, keep in mind that you can empty that leftover mana into Sword of the Power Runes activated ability. The deck also has plenty of mana sinks to prevent ourselves from getting mana burned, but we'll see those cards later. But at least Yurlok equipped with Sword of the Power Runes while you have Nyxbloom Ancient on the battlefield is pretty much game over. You can also use Mana Reflection instead since it's an enchantment and harder to get rid of than a creature, but for one more mana you get a huge beater that can also deal combat damage or be used to block, and it generates way more mana, so it's definitely a meta call, but I prefer the former. Unfortunately, the deck can't run Mana Abundance since it's not legal in constructed formats. With Yurlok in play, every time we generate mana or anyone else does, our opponents generate the same amount of mana. Then if they can't use it, they get severely mana burned. Oh well. Fortunately, there are other legal ways we can have opponents generate more mana than they can use thanks to Magus of the Vineyard, Shizuko Caller of Autumn, and Eldamir's Vineyard. Granted, with Shizuko that mana won't empty after each phase during their turn, but once they reach the end of turn phase, any of that mana they didn't use will burn them. Green is a very common color and most decks in Commander have green in their color identity. If your meta is heavy with green, you might consider swapping these out for other effects, but keep in mind that these effects also help us as well. That being said, if a player can't take advantage of any excess mana, they will burn for it. Besides these, Xur'ta' Ancient, Mana Flare, Dictate of Karametra, and Heartbeat of Spring increment the amount of mana lands tap 4x1. Xur'ta' Ancient is quite the beater, so we have that as well, since we're having players generate tons of mana with this deck. Again, this might seem too group hug at first, but there are ways to prevent opponents from taking too much advantage of all that mana. Keep in mind that these effects are symmetrical, so if opponents are accelerating their game, so are we. So we're still on par. It's just going to make games faster. Keeper of Progenitus also does something similar, but only for mountains, forests, and plains. Obviously, this doesn't contain any plains in this deck, but our mountains and forests will still tap for an additional mana. With the way it's worded, if we tap a dual-type land for mana, we get that color. So tapping down a Blood Crypt for black mana will give us 2 black mana thanks to it. So keep that in mind. Overabundance is the last mana incrementing effect in the deck. However, it's not entirely beneficial. It might give you extra mana, but it pings you each time you tap a land for that mana. And now we finally enter the Groupslug effects of the deck. What I like about Yurlok is that it seems group hug at first until your opponents begin to realize that if they have nothing to do with all that mana, they're going to get burned. However, why wait until phase's end to bring the pain? Besides, overabundance, the deck is also running mana barbs and burning earth. While the first two ping for any land tapped, burning earth pings for any non-basic land tapped. In a multiplayer format like Commander, burning earth is bound to be pinging players. It's also going to be pinging us, but the deck is running 12 basic lands and plenty of mana dorks, so it shouldn't be that big of an issue. Besides hurting players for not using their mana wisely and tapping down their lands, we have to put them into more lose-lose situations, lest they decide to not do what we want. Stoneshaker Shaman, Citadel of Pain, and Power Surge are amazing ways of achieving this. The Shaman has opponents sacrificing an untapped land during their end step, so if they don't want to lose lands each turn, they're going to have to tap out in response to that ability. If they don't use that mana by the time the phase ends, Yurlok mana burns them. The Citadel puts them in a lose-lose position, but they might choose to keep their lands untapped to not get pinged by the previously mentioned Groupslug enchantments on top of not getting mana burn. So while they will lose less life to the Citadel, if they do this, they're still not advancing their board state by not tapping down lands if they choose the path of less pain. Power Surge hurts them if they do not tap down their lands. At the beginning of each player's upkeep, they'll get pinged for every land they untap during their untap step. This makes it even more difficult for players to make decisions when tapping down lands. Again, putting players in that tight spot of the proverbial Brock and a hard place. If that weren't enough, we can augment the pain thanks to Fiery Emancipation, Furnace of Wrath, and Dictate of the Twin Gods. Unfortunately, Yurlok is a life loss effect and not a damage effect, but these previously mentioned enchantments are damage dealing effects. Keep in mind that all of these effects are symmetric, so they do hurt us as well. However, if we're tapping down Yurlok and our other mana dorks and mana rocks for mana, we don't have to worry so much about these group slug effects. In any case, these effects are amazing and making the game go even faster. Faster because of the epic reduction in mana, and faster because of the symmetric pain effects. However, in order to give ourselves an edge over opponents, Fiendish Duo and Wound Reflection are asymmetric pain effects. Fortunately, they each only affect opponents. As a result, the devils don't care about whether the damage opponents receive is from sources you control or not, so if they hurt themselves or each other with their own things or during combat, the damage is still doubled. Wound Reflection is amazing since it will also take mana burn into consideration thanks to the way it's worded. If we manage to get these asymmetric effects out, it can help us with the pain race by having opponents lose more life than we are losing due to those symmetric effects. Pestilence and Pyrohemia are great for this. If the entire table is being dealt damage but we're receiving slightly less, then we'll be able to survive when everyone else receives lethal damage. These enchantments can also be used to wipe the board in a pinch if we have enough mana. Speaking of mana, they also serve as a great mana sink just in case. If we were going to lose life due to mana burn, we might as well invest that mana so that the entire table feels the burn too. Likewise, the deck's running Rolling Earthquake as another painful mana sink. It's an amazing sweeper that will more than likely wipe the board of creatures, or potentially just win us a match with us being the last one standing, since it also deals damage to all players. Thanks to all the damage doublers in the deck, having any of them on the battlefield also reduces how much we have to sink into its cost to really make a lasting impression. Besides these painful Groupslug effects, we have to continue bringing opponents detriment greater than the benefits of our mana doubling Group Hug effects. Spire of Insanity makes it so opponents have to discard their hand at the beginning of each player's end step, not just their own. So this goes also for us. But even if we're gifting them with all this mana, they're going to find a difficult time investing it all if they have to play from the top deck each turn. It also prevents opponents from having things to cast outside of their turn, since they won't have anything in their hand. Speaking of which, City of Solitude and Dulce on the Falling Leaf are included just for that. If we really want to prevent opponents using their mana for anything, they can only be able to use it at sorcery speed. Even then, the city prevents them from even activating abilities outside of their own turn, so if they get a ton of mana during our turn, they can't use it and will significantly get mana burned. Either way, these are also great effects to deal with control players as well. The final Groupslug effects in the deck are Magus of the Moon and Blood Moon. Sure, these combo with Burning Earth, but if opponents aren't running any red, then they're going to be tapping lands to generate mana they can't really use, so it's still lose-lose for them if we have other painful effects on the board. As for us, they can still benefit us since the deck's running 12 basic lands and no utility lands. They even help us tap down fetch lands for mana when we can't afford the life loss to search for a land, besides also shutting down opponents' fetch lands as well. Shutting down opponents' fetch lands with Blood Moon effects is great and all, but Stranglehold outright prevents them from searching for their libraries for answers and responses as well as any of their combo pieces. It also shuts down ramp effects, but we're having the table generate so much mana that opponents might not care as much. However, this helps us even further maintain our board by making it as difficult as possible for opponents to deal with it. Alright, now besides Fiendish Duo and Wound Reflection to help us win the pain race, we can't just haphazardly burn and bring the pain to the entire table because that still involves us as well. We need to also include ways to mitigate that pain by either preventing it entirely, reducing it, or recovering from it. Believe it or not, Ursa's Armor is an amazing card in this deck. It's a bit costly at 6 mana, but the deck is generating a ton of mana anyways. The reason why it's so good is that almost all of the ping effects deal 1 damage each time. So if you were to receive 1 damage from tapping a land, the armor reduces it to 0. Even if you had multiple pain effects on the battlefield, it's each card that's dealing 1 damage. So whereas you might take 3 damage total each time you tap a land, the armor makes it so that you take 0 instead. What's great about this is that it also works with the damage doubling effects. If you were to take 1 damage from an enchantment for tapping your land, the armor reduces that damage to 0, and then the damage doubler doubles 0, so you still end up taking 0 damage. Also, if you activate Pestilence and Pyrohemia, you'll take 0 damage from each even if you sink a ton of mana into them, because these enchantments deal the 1 damage at a time per activation. And 0 plus 0 a bunch of times is still 0. However, this isn't the case for X damage effects. But even if you're taking X damage from a source, at least it'll be X minus 1 damage. Oh, and a horde of 1-1 tokens won't deal damage to you either. Again, an amazing card in this deck. If we are running low on life and can't deal with the Groupslug effects, the deck's running Claws of Gix and Shattergang Brothers as a panic button. All the deck's hate cards are either creatures or enchantments. Thanks to the Claws, we can pay 1 generic and sacrifice any pain effect if we're out of life or death for us. Same goes for the Brothers. What's great about the Brothers is that we can weaponize that panic button. So if we had to pull the plug on one of our hate pieces, an opponent loses something of theirs as a bonus also. In fact, the entire table does. Also, notice how much mana it takes to activate Shattergang Brothers. So it also serves as a great mana sink for Yurlok's 3 mana. These cards can also be used to get rid of our group hug effects if they're benefiting an opponent way more than they are us. We don't want to king make with this deck, we want to pauper make with it. If we have either Gemstone Array or Horizon Stone on the battlefield, then we don't have to worry about the mana burn from all the mana we're generating. This will also help us win any resource race against our opponents, so we might not have to sacrifice those effects with the Claws or the Brothers. We can sink any leftover mana into Gemstone Array in order to store it at a 2-for-1 ratio. Horizon Stone outright prevents us from getting mana burned since it has a replacement effect for mana leaving our mana pool. So this overrides your Yurlok's effect. So instead of getting burned, we simply get colorless mana. This is also amazing for not losing our mana either. So we should be able to accumulate a ton of mana thanks to it. Other ways of winning the pain race is to simply gain a ton of life. The deck's running Erebos' Intervention and Nourishing Shoal as instant speed ways of gaining X life. If we have a ton of mana, then in response to the pain effects resolving from the stack, we can cast either of these to gain enough life where we can survive the pain while our opponents potentially die. Or we can simply sink a ton of mana into these at the end of the turn before ours to put us ahead. As a bonus, Erebos' Intervention is an amazing spot removal spell that can get around Indestructible and Regeneration. Battle at the Bridge and Exsanguinate are sorcery speed ways of gaining X life. Just as with the Intervention, Battle at the Bridge can simultaneously be used to get rid of almost any creature. Exsanguinate, on the other hand, has the potential to just win you the game on the spot if you're able to sink enough mana into it. Keep in mind that the deck generates a ton of mana. Sinking it all into Exsanguinate might very easily end the game. At the very least, it will put you leagues ahead of your opponents in the pain race, not just because you're gaining a ton of life, but that life you gain is thrice as much as they're losing, so it's widening the gap even further. A similar way to really widen the gap is with Exquisite Blood. Every time your opponents lose life or get damaged, you gain that much life. So whenever these symmetric pain effects affect everyone, so long as you survive, you can potentially gain thrice as much life as what you lost thanks to your opponent's pain. This is possibly the best card in the deck to deal with the Groupslug effects. You just have to make sure that you survive long enough for its effect to resolve. Besides sinking mana into life-gaining abilities to make use of any mana that might burn us later, we can also sink that mana into drawing effects. First card that comes to mind is Seera Iron. For the same mana as Yurlok taps for tapping, you can draw a card at instant speed. She's also a 1-2 flyer for 3 mana, so she passes a vanilla test. Thanks to her flying, she can be used as a chump blocker in a pinch as well. Similarly, the Scorpion God can also be activated with exactly the same mana Yurlok taps for, using the green for the generic. Granted, it doesn't draw you the card right away, but it does disrupt opponents by putting a -1/-1 counter on one of their creatures. So this can also be used to ping weenies, mana dorks, and eventually hate bears. Then, if a creature did die because of it, you draw a card. It also returns to your hand at the end of a turn if it were to die, which is quite a bonus. A 6-5 body for 5 mana isn't anything to scoff at either. Erebos God of the Dead, Greed, and Ardual's Bloodfast play around the mana burn by drawing you a card for that life loss. So instead of losing your mana and getting burned by Yurlok, sink it into these enchantments to draw a card for that same amount of life you would have lost anyways. Thanks to the way they're worded, since it's life loss and not damage, then the pain is not augmented by the deck's Groupslug effects. That being said, if we do manage to have our life total go down too low, the Blood Flash transforms into Temple of Aklasos. This land can still tap for mana, but it can be used as a free sacrifice outlet to gain life via a creature in a pinch. So if our life total drops so low that this transforms, we're going to go into survival mode. Hopefully you draw into the life gaining or damage preventing effects of the deck. Speaking of which, Vilis Broker of Blood also draws you cards at the cost of mana and 2 life. However, similarly to the Scorpion God, it has the potential of killing off creatures when it does. Vilis costs a whopping 8 mana to cast, but that isn't an issue when you're generating so much mana. However, you don't need to pay mana to draw cards with Villas. With all the pain you're receiving in the deck and life you're losing, you're going to be drawing into a ton of cards. So hopefully you can soon after close the game or get yourself out of the hole. He's also an 8/8 flyer, so you can very easily send him towards an opponent at low life and kill him off one at a time once the pain has gotten to them. Other ways we can sink our mana is what decks should be doing anyways, which is interacting. The deck's running Beast Within, Chaos Warp, and Assassin's Trophy. In order to get rid of any permanent and instant speed, Chaos Warp and Assassin's Trophy might get them something from the deck, but at least a Stranglehold would prevent the opponent from ramping with Assassin's Trophy, assuming they have any basic lands left in their library. Windgrace's Judgment, Casualties of War, and Decimate are wider forms of removal since they can potentially destroy a ton of problematic permanents. They are considerably more expensive than the instant speed ones, but the deck does generate a ton of mana, and in a multiplayer format like this one, they can cause quite a lot of disdain to opponents, potentially more so than our group slug effects. Lavalanche and Shatter Skull Smashing can also potentially get rid of things while also serving as a mana sink. Shatter Skull Smashing can take out two creatures and our planeswalkers. However, what's great about this is that it doesn't take up a slot in the deck since it's a modular double-faced card. At the cost of 3 life, we can play it untapped. However, this is only if we need Shatter Skull the Hammer Pass to enter the battlefield untapped. But if we do draw this early game and really need that land drop, just use it as a land. Lavalanche can not only potentially kill off an opponent, but even if they survive, with all of the damage increasing, doubling, and tripling effects, we'll still more than likely wipe their board of creatures. One side elite to boost, so we still keep our own things. As for opponents' responses of their own, Heroic Intervention can give Hexproof and Indestructible to all of our own permanents. So that means that all of our enchantments are also protected from mass removal. So any opponents trying to ease their pain by wiping the board is going to feel even more pain when they simply wipe theirs and everyone else's board except for ours. Agadeem's Awakening is a great card just in case our board is dealt with, specifically our creatures. So it's not only an amazing mana sink, but it will reanimate a lot of creatures from our graveyard. Unfortunately, it is limited to those creatures having different casting costs, so make your choices wisely. That being said, it doesn't take up a slot in the deck since it could be played as Agadeem the Undercrypt if we really needed a land in the early game. If we really needed that mana for whatever reason, it can at least enter the battlefield untapped at the cost of 3 life. Do try and avoid this if your life total is too low though. Since getting Yurlok early out can wrap us quite a bit as well to begin giving our opponents pain early on too, the deck's running Birds of Paradise, Finhorn Elves, Llanowar Elves, and Elvish Mystic. I would run Elves of Deep Shadow over any of the other elves just to diversify colors, but the point of having these dorks is to not depend too much on the lands for when it becomes too painful to tap them, so tapping a dork down for damage isn't ideal. As for Mana Rocks, the deck's running Sol Ring, Arcane Signet, Golgari Signet, Gruul Signet, and Rakdos Signet. Now, I'm running the Guild Signets over my usual trifecta for this deck because having too many lands proved to be too dangerous for the deck when testing. Although it wasn't too big an issue, the fact remains that tapping down other sources for mana was better in the long run since the enchantments only ping us when we tap down lands. Also, it's not like we're playing lands at all, so we're not missing out on the mana doubling effects for tapping lands for mana either. This is just to further reduce the pain from the symmetric group slug effects in the deck. The rest of the deck is just the rest of the lands. The deck's running all 10 fetch lands, all 3 dual lands, all 3 shock lands, all 3 battle bond lands, command tower, and reflecting pool, as well as 4 of each snow-covered basic land in case anyone is running anything that benefits us for it. 12 basics don't really set this deck back as much since Yurlok filters mana. And as mentioned earlier, we need that many basics because of Blood Moon effects, which in this case, we're the ones running them. As always, the dual lands are not entirely necessary for the deck to run, and you can just as easily swap them out for any budget substitutes, and the deck will still run well enough. Just make sure that you don't add any pain lands as those substitutes, since we don't want to get hurt too badly from tapping down lands in this deck. This brew is just an idea of how to build around Yurlok Scorch Thrash. Groupslug was the first thing that came to mind when I first saw Yurlok, and I'm glad I won this route. Its colors pair really well for this kind of strategy since you're also taking advantage of all the mana production. So even the group hub aspects of the deck become an additional pain rather than solely a blessing with Yurlok on the battlefield. This is what I love about the deck. Yurlok makes even group hug effects become group slug. If you're interested in the decklist of this spicy brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of the Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I am the Demented Kirby, and happy brewing!